الحمد لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على رسولنا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ومن آياته أن خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: يا معشر الشباب، من استطاع منكم الباعة فليتزوج فإنه أغض للبصر. صدق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, today we are here, we have gathered together to share the joy of our brother Muslim on a day which is memorable for almost every person in his life, the day when he gets married. So initially we start off with a dua. May Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this nikah and may this couple live happily with peace of mind. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we look into the wide world we live in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created this universe in such a way, in such a system, that each and every person is dependent upon the other person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create everybody as a wealthy man, nor did He create every person as a poor man. He has created a few as rich men and another few as poor men. If the case was everybody was rich and fine, they were well off, there won't be anybody in the farm to plow the fields, to till the land and to do the farming. And if we take the other way around, if the whole world was full of poor people, there wasn't a single affluent man, the case would be there won't be anybody to buy these farmers' products. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the whole world in a balanced manner so that every human being could live comfortably without any trouble. So we see, even though there might be different levels amongst the people, there are certain needs which every person Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. For an example, every person undergoes hunger. He comes across hunger, so he needs to fulfill, he needs to satisfy. What does he do? He goes for some food, he has it, then he's fine. If a person is feeling thirsty, he has to quench it, so he gets some water and he's fine. Likewise, a person wants to relax, he wants to take some rest, so he lies down and mashallah, he's fine. And likewise, respected brothers and elders in Islam, in the stage of a human being's life, a time comes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places in that human being that urge for a partner. It is a natural thing which comes into every human being when he reaches a certain age. He feels that he wants a partner whereby which he could pacify himself, where he could feel comfortable, where he could have his private things discussed, to share his thoughts. He needs somebody. So naturally he wants someone, and this is what we call as nikah. Allah Rabbul Izzat in His Holy Quran, He mentions the ayat al-Karima which I had recited before you. Allah says it is amongst His signs, it is amongst the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has created your partners. He says, if we have created your partners amongst yourselves, that means amongst the human race, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the partner. Not from any other races, like as the jinnat or etc. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created our spouses amongst the human race. And thereafter He says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And He had placed among, by that marriage, He has placed love and caring between the two partners. Love and caring between the two partners. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And thereafter He finishes the ayat, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Verily there is a sign, there is a lesson for those who ponder. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, the tafsir, ulama of tafsir, when they interpret this verse, they give two meanings for the two words which I have quoted to you. One is the word mawadda and the other is the word rahma. The word mawadda and rahma, even though outwardly might mean the same, it means love, care, affection, compassion and all that. But ulama write that initially when a person gets married, when they are very young, they are they are attractive to each other. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places a natural love in them because they look very nice, they look very attractive. So that is the first type of love which every person experiences in the initial stages of his marriage life. Then the next word which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses is warahma. The word rahma is also somewhat similar to the same meaning, but the ulama of tafsir write that is the rahma, the care which comes in the latter stages of every human being's life. That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means in this ayah. When both the spouses become very old, they need some company, they need to help each other. So there we see passion is gone off and compassion comes into the man's life, and likewise to the other spouse. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we look into a marriage, basically it is the foundation stone for a civilization. It is not merely two people getting together and they start their family life, but in reality it is the foundation stone for a whole civilization. Adam alayhi salatu was salam, when he was created, he was alone in paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Hawa alayhi salam and made her his partner. So what happened? We see thousands of years pass and now we see billions of people in the world. Likewise, when two people get married, it is the foundation stone for a civilization to emerge on the face of this earth. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, it is a very important thing that every person, if a person is able to find the true peace in mind by nikah, he has achieved success. And Allah forbid, Allah should protect all our nikahs, if the things turn upside down, if he couldn't find the real tranquility, real peace of mind in his life, he has failed. So therefore, respected brothers and elders in Islam, if each and every person on the face of this earth, if he understands the responsibility which he owes towards others and he fulfills it in a correct manner, obviously this whole world is going to be a pleasant place to live. Let us take, if an employer is not playing his part, but he expects the employee to do his part, we see that there would be some friction there. And likewise, if a father expects his son to be obedient to him, but the father doesn't behave in such a way, and the son expects the father to fulfill his rights, but the son behaves in the opposite way, obviously there is going to be friction in that life. So likewise, respected brothers and elders in Islam, in marriage, when two spouses get together, each one of them should understand their responsibility, and if they could play their part in a correct manner, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make both of them enjoy that life. Both of them to enjoy that life. We see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya ma'ashara shabab, O youngsters, man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj. Whoever amongst you who could afford to get married, if you could pay your mahar and you could look after the expenditure afterwards, let him get married. And what did he say next? He said, فَإِنَّهُ أَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ. Because of this person getting married, it is going to protect him from casting evil glances. Number one. And number two, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَأَحْسَنُ لِلْفَرْضِ. And it is the best way a person can safeguard his private parts from haram. So we see the foundation, the objective of the nikah was a person, for the person is so that he could protect himself from haram. The nikah should make that person who married, he should come to that extent that he could lower his gaze. He could protect himself from haram. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, let us see a few points. Key factors, there are many, out of that I have just chosen a few, which should play a vital role in bringing up a very happy family. Number one is, respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we see the manner in which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam conducted his majalis of nikah, which took place at his time, he would mention the ayats of taqwa in his bayan. O mankind, fear Allah. O people, fear Allah. These were the ayats which were quoted by Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam on the day when a person is having the happiest day in his life. Why does Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam need to quote these ayahs? What is the relationship between taqwa and marriage? Respected brothers and elders in Islam, it is basic. When a person hasn't got taqwa in his life, he hasn't got God consciousness in him. Obviously, the laws of Allah, the rules which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed upon him, is not going to be very effective on him. Only when he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would play his part in the correct way as a husband. And likewise, the wife, she would feel that if I don't fulfill my rights towards my husband, I will be questionable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. So I have to be a conscious person. So that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to recite the ayats related to the fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the majlis of nikah. So as we get married, how is it possible to implement taqwa in our life? Respected brothers and elders in Islam, first and foremost we should understand that taqwa is not merely for a person to restrict himself inside the masjid. No, it is rather, it is vast. The doors of taqwa are even wide open. We see, one is a side where we focus more on ibadah. A person is very conscious regarding his prayers. He prays on time. His salatul fajr is on time. That is the part with where the ibadah plays in his taqwa. And another part is, respected brothers and elders in Islam, when he has got good akhlaq in him. He has got good akhlaq in him, good morals, good qualities in him. That also plays in this person's life. If a person has got only ibadah and devoid of good akhlaq, even that is going to be a minus point. And likewise, if a person has good akhlaq, devoid of spiritual guidance, even that is going to play a bad role in life. So to taking a balanced track between the two, every spouse should understand that I should be a God-fearing person. I should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the person who is going to seek for the rizq, he should see that the spouse should see that he gets the halal source. He should see that the income is halal, so that he feeds his family what is halal, so that he would see what is fruitful and he will not see what upsets him. That is number one. And number two, respected brothers and elders in Islam, it is a general thing which most of us are weak in. It is for a person to control his anger. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in a hadith with regard to anger, he said, none of you should consider yourself powerful just because you can overpower somebody else. But the person who is really powerful is the person who can suppress his anger. A person who can suppress his anger. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we take the aspect of anger, managing anger in life, it plays a vital role. It plays a vital role. Maybe we have spent our time at the workplace, and when we return back home, they would come up with their issues, they want to tell us something, and we are tired after work. And if a person is unable to control his anger, he would just shout at his wife and she would feel bad. So when this continues for some time, she feels that I haven't got any respect in front of this man. It doesn't seem that he's interested in me, and he's not showing any affection towards me, and she feels that my life is gone. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, when it comes to anger, the best remedy for this is for both spouses is to be quiet, to keep silent. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi, the imam we all of us are familiar with, Hafil Abu Ulay Samarkand rahmatullahi alayhi, in his kitab Tanbihul Ghafilin, he mentions that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi, when his wife had passed away, he told his companions, I lived with this lady for 40 years. I lived with this lady for 40 years. But there never came a time in my life that I had disputed with her. They said, how is it possible? It is natural that both, there will be ups and downs. Words will be exchanged. How come you lived like that for 40 years? He said, whenever I lost my temper, and whenever I wanted to argue with her with regard to something, she never spoke a word. She kept quiet. She was silent. And likewise, whenever she wanted to argue with me, or she lost her temper, I never spoke a word. So obviously both of us had this quality in us. So both of us didn't have an argument in life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that patience in life, inshallah. And respected brothers and elders in Islam, in a hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنة. Let not a believer hate his wife, his spouse, just because she has got some qualities which doesn't please him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not created every human being has some error. That is the nature. Maybe a husband sees some fault in the wife which displeases him, which he cannot bear it. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you see something like that, you would obviously find something good in her. Maybe she cannot get your stuff cooked properly, or she has some minor issues, ups and downs, it doesn't matter. But when you ask her to do some responsibility, she does it perfectly. You see the good part of her and you forget the bad part of it. Because of this, what happens? A person will be grateful. A person will become grateful to his spouse. And respected brothers and elders in Islam, as we all know, Umar radiallahu anhu was a very courageous man. He was a very courageous, he was very brave. That was his nature. But when it came to his family, when it comes to his family life, we see he said, it is a weakness in women that they lose their temper. So if you want to find a remedy for that, just keep quiet. These are the words of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu. He said, to treat the weakness of women, the best remedy for you is to keep quiet. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, we ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us that quality as well. And finally, the last quality is something which is very difficult these days for a person to have. It is to spend our time with our spouse. Spending some productive time. What I mean is productive time. Some feel, mashallah, I've finished my office work and I get back home at 6, so I'm present at home. No, it is not like marking in a register that I was inside the house, but the spouse and the children should feel that my husband, my father is in our presence. They should feel that. So how could he bring that? We see that some of them, when they get back home, some men, they are busy with their computers, they are busy with something else. So the whole day he spent nearly 7 to 8 hours outside. He had friends to share his ideas, he joked, he spoke to them, he did all sorts of things, and he comes back home once he finished everything. But whereas this lady at home, she was seated there since morning, she's all alone at home, nobody to speak to. And when this man comes home, she just goes in front and says, how was your day today? How was your day? They said, keep quiet, not now. She feels what? So long, so many hours I didn't have him. When he comes home and when I ask him something, he gives this response. She feels bad. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, whether we are married or we are about to get married, whoever, if we have this in our life, we have to give it up. Because it is the nature of women, they want to put out what is in their hearts. When something disturbs, they want to tell it out. They can't bear it. We see when a person is vomiting, we never go and stop, ask him, stop, what did you have? What did they have for breakfast? We never ask that question from him. We tell him, okay, you vomit, khalas, you are comfortable. Now you tell me, what did you have? Likewise, respected brothers, when our spouse comes in front of us and she says some problem, you know, women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them weak. To tell a small issue, they might take a long way. Finally, we as men will understand, oh, this is what she wants to tell us. But we must know that is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them, and appreciate that. But we should say, you tell your problem out, you listen to them, and you say, this is the solution for this. If not, when she starts speaking about the problem, halfway you stop and you say, ah, khalas, you do this and khalas, you just leave the place, I have some work to do. No. If that is the case, respected brothers, we see so many families, Allah protect all of us, they are shattered. Even though they might go in the same vehicle, their hearts are not together. Outwardly the world might envy, mashallah, they are well off, they are living luxuriously, you know, they are very, very wealthy. The world might say that, but inside the house both hearts are not together. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, we should spend time at home productively in such a way that they would feel that this man is, he loves me. Maybe at our workplace or when we are going out for somewhere, some reason, we could just drop a message. We could just send a SMS to them. The breakfast you did, you prepared in the morning was, mashallah, delicious. Just a message. When they read that, oh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would, there would be love in their heart. So when you get back home, you would see a warm welcome. When they do something, they cook something, never find fault in that. Be grateful. They say, mashallah, the dish is fine. It's really tasty. Next time when you cook, just try to add this, it will be even more tastier. Rather than saying, no salt, if a person says, if you add a bit more salt, you want to say the same message, but you chose a different way. With a smile, if you can convince her with something, wallahi, that marriage life is going to be really happy. And also, while at home, maybe in our lives we will come across certain things, we have to take decisions. Maybe a person wants to buy a car, for an example. He says, I want to go for this car. And the spouse says, fine, let's go for it. But there's a problem. Both of them having contradictions regarding one thing. What is it? The color of the car. He says, it's black. Or she says, it's white. Wallahi, if this color, this contradiction, this color problem is going to cause havoc in the family, wallahi, it is better to give preference for her wish. The color of the car, it doesn't matter. Maybe in the whole year, 365 days, we might come across 3 to 4 major issues to be discussed or to make a decision. Maybe which school are we going to enroll our sons, our daughters? It is a decision which has to be made after a lot of thinking. There maybe we have to consider a lot. We have to ask them, please give up. You know, this is something related to our children. We have to think very far. When we take decisions, we have to think very far. We see Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, when he prayed to Almighty Allah, he was thinking about the progeny which is to come. He said, Ya Allah, make me a person who performs salat. This was the dua of Hazrat Ibrahim. Make me amongst those who perform salat. And likewise, Ya Allah, make my progeny to perform salat. What a dua. His sight was very far-sighted. He was a far-sighted man. And another dua he said, Ya Allah, protect my progeny from shirk. Protect my progeny from shirk. Maybe the 7th generation down the line, Ya Allah, protect them from shirk, because they came from me. So marriage, as I mentioned to you, it is a foundation for a civilization. So if we think very broadly before we make dua, before we take decisions in life, wallahi, even though we have left this world, we might be in our graves, but the deeds, the rewards for the deeds which are done by our little ones would surely come to our grave. So these are the few things. Number one is taqwa. Number two is to control our temper, our anger. The best remedy I mentioned, to keep silent. And number three was to spend time productively at home with our spouse and our children. Three things which causes weakness in a marriage life. One is to ignore them. One is ignoring our spouse. Early in the morning, they're giving us salam. We just ignore the salam because something happened last night, still disturbing our hearts. We are not ready to respond to their salam. Wallahi, when we ignore them in this manner, it is going to affect their life. Number two, when a husband starts to lie, he camouflages something, he says something else, he doesn't speak the truth, and the long run there'll be problems in life. Allah forbid. And number three is to break a promise. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, in a hadith it comes, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, lying is permissible, but it is not a blatant lie. Maybe we got a call when we were in office, when you're coming after work, get this stuff from the supermarket. So on our way we forgot. Obviously, might have forgotten. We reach home and they ask, where are the stuff? If you say I forgot, they will feel bad. So according to the hadith, we're not going to lie. You'd say, I thought of taking you also along with me to the supermarket. So she will be happy. She will not feel bad. What did you say? We didn't say I forgot. We said, I wanted to take you along with me. So that's what I came home. She said, MashaAllah. She wants to take me for shopping. This is the way we tackle certain problems in our lives. And respected brothers and elders in Islam, finish this off. We see Hazrat Salman radiallahu anhu was a companion of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he got married, when he went into the room, he went to his wife and he held on to the forelock and he recited the dua. If we can memorize that dua and practice it in our life, the first day we are going to meet our wives, he recited the dua, Allahumma inni as'aluka khairaha. O Allah, I seek you, I ask you for the goodness of her. Allahumma inni as'aluka khairaha wa khaira ma jabaltaha alay. And I ask you for the goodness for what she has been created. And also I seek refuge from the evil of this person, and also from the evil for what she has been created. This could be recited by the wife as well to the husband, and both parties could recite this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bless them. Thereafter, Hazrat Salman radiallahu anhu said to his wife, before he started anything, he didn't even start speaking to her, he said, my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised me, the day I get married and I see my wife for the first time, he asked me to start my life with an action which is complying to the obedience of Allah. So he said to his wife, come, let us both pray some salah. And he led her in salat, and soon after they recited a few dua and their family life started. If we also could do this in our life, maybe that is the moment which every person waits for. If we have some sabr, control ourselves, and we start off with the dua and then salat, we lead them in salat, and thereafter after salat both parties can recite dua. Either both, one can say Ameen and the other reads the dua, or individually they could ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because all khair is from him, so we need to get the khair from him. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, mashallah, we are having the nikah majlis in the masjid. Just as we are having all these things, we initiate with Islamically, we should see that everything end up also as Islamical. And other thing is, there shouldn't be any extravagance in our nikahs, without any wastage, without any israf, if you could conduct our nikahs. And also un-Islamic, whatever is un-Islamic, just for the sake of Allah, if we leave it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down a lot of khair in it. We ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this nikah and provide, to sustain, to grant them children who would become a coolness to their eyes, those children who will bring tears of joy to their parents. And may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this marriage strengthen the bond to the extent that they would also become the same spouses in the Jannah which is to come.